Now, even the question of monks' DPR comes with a major caveat, and that is the fact that a huge part of what monks do is facilitate improvements in DPR to other characters. Take, for example, the monk's most popular ability, Stunning Strike. Stunning Strike might allow the monk character to get advantage on several attacks over the next round, which can have a decent bump of 10 to 20 points for those 2 turns, but the real advantage of this feature is to shut down that enemy for an entire turn and provide advantage to every single other player who chooses to attack that creature. Now that 10 to 20 points can be massive for something like a Great Weapon Master, Polearm Master, Paladin, who benefits hugely from advantage on 3 attacks while taking the -5 attack plus 10 damage feature. Not to mention the increased crit chance and the effect there on Paladin Smites. That's one additional character. A party may have 3, 4, 5, or more additional characters. With the right party, a stunned enemy can meet a dead enemy by that monk's next turn, and that shows up as only 10 points of additional damage, or just over 1 DPR when averaged out. The point here is that DPR can't capture this, and it's not meant to capture this, so it's important for us to fully understand what that DPR number means. Now, you may be saying, for Stunning Strike specifically, well, yeah, but the chance to land a Stunning Strike is pretty small. How much of a factor is this really? I was firmly in this camp until I ran the numbers. The chance of landing a Stunning Strike can be low. It's a DC based off the monk's wisdom, so it won't be very high, unless you focus on increasing that wisdom. Most monks focus on dex. And it targets Constitution saves, the highest creature saving throw bonus in the game on average, which is the opposite of what you want. But here's the thing, there's something in probability called binomial distribution and the law of iterated expectation. Simply put, this can be thought of as the probability of a success or failure outcome in an experiment that is repeated multiple times. We can calculate this using this formula. In our case, let's assume at level 13 you have a DC 17 Stunning Strike. Average CR 13 creatures have a +7 to their con saving throws. The chance of landing a single Stunning Strike on a single attempt may only be 45%, so the majority of the time you will fail. And the chance of landing a Stunning Strike on your next attempt will also be the same 45%. But, and this is a major but, the chance of landing a single Stunning Strike from both of those attempts is not 45%. It increases to 69.75%. Why? Because you've given yourself more than one chance to get the single result you want. What happens with a third attempt? That increases to 83.4%. 4 chances? Up to 90.8%. You see what happened there? You can take an ability in Stunning Strike that fails the majority of the time, 55%, and give yourself an almost certain chance of landing it, all in the same turn. By spending 4 key points and essentially spamming the Stunning Strike feature, you have a 91% chance to stun the enemy. Now you and all your allies have advantage to attack that enemy without the enemy having a chance to retaliate. In addition to advantage on attacks for your Great Weapon Master and Sharpshooter users, the stunned creature auto-fails both strength and dexterity saving throws. The wizard isn't going to waste this opportunity on an advantage 3d10 firebolt, but an auto-failed lightning bolt may be worth it, especially for a high dex creature. Oh, the Swarmkeeper Ranger laid down a spike growth last turn, and the super strong enemy got out on its turn? Doesn't matter. The stunned creature auto-fails those strength saving throws, so now the swarm can just push that stunned enemy 15 feet right back into the spike growth. Go ahead and take 2d4 damage every 5 feet too.